Previously, we have seen how we can control the electron spin of the NV center in diamond as a qubit. In this lecture, we will learn how we can use the NV center to also control multiple nuclear spin qubits and how we can link NV centers together using photons to create quantum networks. The first thing to realize is that this electron spin is surrounded by an entire cloud of nuclear spins. About 1% of the diamond consists of carbon-13, which is a spin half system, and the rest consists of carbon-12, which has no spin. Now, normally speaking, these nuclear spins are a source of decoherence. They flip-flop around randomly and create a slowly varying magnetic field on the NV center. So if we prepare the NV center in a quantum superposition state, then this fluctuating magnetic field changes the NV energy levels, and that causes its phase evolution to become random so that the quantum state is lost. And this dephasing time is only about 5 microseconds. It's not that long. But luckily, we can play a trick. We can apply a pulse that inverts the state of the NV, that is, we flip it, and this also inverts the effect of the magnetic field on the spin. So, if we have the same time before and after this flip, then the effect of the field exactly cancels and the quantum state is protected. And we call this a spin echo. And of course, this cancellation only works if the magnetic field is constant over time. But don't worry, as long as the field fluctuates slowly, we can just flip the electron spin multiple times faster and faster so that everything still averages out. Now, in this graph, you can see that this works. We bring the electron spin in a superposition, and as we apply more and more pulses, we protect the electron spin longer and longer. And in this way, we can even protect the quantum state for over a second. So really over macroscopic timescales, and about 6 orders of magnitude better than without flipping the electron spin. So we just have very good coherence for the electron spin. How can we now use this to control multiple nuclear spins in the environment? And the key here is that if the electron spin is, let's say, in a state pointing downwards, then it creates a dipolar magnetic field, and each nuclear spin has a different position and angle from the electron spin, so that each of them feels a different magnetic field. And this gives each nuclear spin a unique frequency, so we can apply radio frequency pulses that are resonant only with particular targeted nuclear spins. So we can selectively control the spins. Moreover, if we now flip the electron to its zero state, it does not create a magnetic field. So now the same RF pulse will have no effect on the nuclear spin. The evolution of the nuclear spin thus depends on the state of the electron spin. It rotates if the electron spin is in state 1, but it doesn't rotate for state 0. So this means we have constructed a controlled quantum gate between the electron and the nuclear spin, AC naught. And that is exactly what we need for quantum computations. So this enables us to control multiple nuclear spins near a single NV center, and each NV center becomes a system of 5 or even more qubits. So how do we link these NV centers together into a network? And for that, we use photons. Consider 2 NV centers in 2 different diamonds. We first make each of these NV centers emit a photon that is entangled with the spin state. And then we take these 2 photons and we bring them together on a beam splitter. And after this beam splitter, it is fundamentally impossible to tell which photon came from which NV center. So this means that if the detectors behind the beam splitter register a certain pattern of photons, then we know that, for example, one of the NV centers is pointing up and the other one is pointing down. And because we fundamentally cannot know which one is up and which one is down, quantum mechanics tells us that we have created an entangled state between 2 distant NV centers. Now note that this does not succeed every time we try. Not all measurement outcomes lead to entanglement, and photons are also often lost on the way to the detectors. Now, this is not a problem because we're just trying to create entanglement to use it as a resource to perform quantum computation in our network. So we can just keep trying and trying until we get the right measurement outcome, which then heralds the generation of our entangled state, and then we can use it in the network. Now this works. Here you see a state-of-the-art experiment in Delft, where we created entanglement between one NV center in the physics building, all the way on the left, and another NV center all the way on the right, about 1.3 kilometers away at the other side of the Delft campus. And this experiment was done to provide a more stringent test if this quantum entanglement really exists. Now the outcome was yes, quantum mechanics is still correct, so we can now go and use this entanglement to build quantum networks for quantum technology. The next big step there will be to combine the control of multiple qubits in each node with these optical links to generate entanglement in order to build increasingly larger and larger quantum networks. Now, of course, there are still many challenges. We need really good control over all these spins and photons. We need to understand how to efficiently run quantum computations and error correction over these networks. And we need to build the complex electronics and software to control these networks. Now, for this, we'll need physics, quantum computer science, and engineering to come together. And it will be really exciting to see if we can actually build large-scale quantum networks and make quantum computation and quantum cryptography a reality.